Hello, my name is Stan Copeland, and I'm the senior pastor of Walnut Hill Church, a ministry of Lovers Lane United Methodist Church. We are a church, a congregation that meets on two campuses, the Walnut Hill Church campus on Marsh Lane and the Lovers Lane Church campus on Inwood Road at Northwest Highway. Who would have thought that months ago we would still be meeting on our live stream and not meeting in person for worship? And yet that still is the case. We'll be informing you as to when in-person worship will resume. But in the meantime, thank you for streaming live worship this morning, and let's go to the house of the Lord for worship.
Good morning. I hope you all are wearing your mask and keeping each other safe. I welcome you to this worship service online at Walnut Hill Church, a ministry of Lovers Lane United Methodist Church in Dallas, Texas. My name is Reverend Tom Hutchbeth, and I'm the pastor for congregational care here at Walnut Hill Church, and I am looking forward to getting to know our congregation as I minister with and among you as we worship and serve Christ together, along with our teaching pastor, Andy Nelms, and our executive pastor, Scott Luganbill. Please let us know of your attendance today, if you would take a moment to click the attendance button there on the screen at our website of whumc.com. And if you would go to there and let us know if you're attending today, we certainly appreciate so that we may get in touch with you during the week. May we begin now our worship. For where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is the one true church, apostolic and universal, whose holy faith let us now declare. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. On the third day, he rose from the dead, and he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From then he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
So happy to see you again this morning. I got up to mow the yard and I threw on this t-shirt. And it's a t-shirt from a youth mission week from a few years ago. And it says, do what others won't. And this was a mission week that they went around in our community and helped older people in our community. Things like repairing their houses or painting houses or repairing porches or mowing lawns. And as I was thinking about that week, I was thinking about that everybody on that mission team had a job. Everybody had something to do. Some people climbed high on ladders and they painted the house. And some people weren't as comfortable on ladders, and so they stood at the bottom and held it so that their friend on the top of that ladder was safe. Some people used power saws and cut wood and screwed in boards so that porches could be repaired. And some people stood on those repaired porches and talked to the homeowner so that they would know that they were loved by God. You know, we are all called to do something. We're separated right now and things are strange, but we can still do something to help other people know that they are loved by God. You know, in Matthew, Jesus talks about people who are thirsty and who are hungry and who are in prison and who are sick, and I would bet lonely or hurting. We're called to do something about that, to help them in some way. You are called to do something. Micah 6:8, one of my favorite scriptures, says, "What does the Lord require of you but to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with your God?" Do something so that people know that they are loved by God. A few weeks ago, my husband Scott was sick. And do you know, someone came over and mowed our yard just so that we would know that they loved us and that God loves us. You can do something. You can help clean up or mow someone's yard. You can write a note or draw a picture to someone who's lonely or someone that you miss. You can come up to church on Mondays or Thursdays and pack food bags, or come on Tuesdays and be in the parking lot and wave at people so that they know that they are loved by God. You can do something. I'm excited to see what you're going to do this week. Email me or send me some pictures. Let me know what you're doing so that people know that they are loved by God. You are loved by God. So go do something. See you soon.
Deep river. Good morning. Again, my name is Andy Nelms, and I have the privilege of being the new teaching pastor here at Walnut Hill, and am so excited to be with you and worship with you. I want to thank our guest musicians. I want to thank Rose and Nadine for being here this morning, while our choir director, Christine, received some much-deserved time away with family. And so we pray for Christine and her travels, and thank our congregation for their support in worship. Before we get into the word, I ask that you just join me in a brief word of prayer. God, we thank you so much for this time together. Wherever we are gathered, in whatever way we are gathered, we pray now that you would speak directly to our hearts and our minds. God, that your will would be illumined in Scripture, and that in everything your kingdom would come to this earth. We ask it in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Well, as I mentioned last week, for the next couple of weeks, we're going to be in just a special series called Get to Know Me, as your new teaching pastor, just want to share a little bit about myself, my story, and some of my favorite scriptures with you. And so I had the privilege of being with you last week as we talked about Genesis 12 and the call of Abram, and one of my favorite stories. And now this morning, we're going to talk a little bit about the Gospel of Matthew. But before we do that, I wanted to tell you a little bit about my upbringing. As I mentioned before, I am from a small town in Oklahoma called Coweta, Oklahoma. Some people might ask, where is Coweta? Where is that? Well, I have a map here for you. It is northeast Oklahoma, just southeast of Tulsa. I'm about 20 minutes southeast of Tulsa, and it's there is a small town. You can see Highway 51 comes out of Tulsa through Broken Arrow, and right there is Coweta on the way. And I was very privileged to be a part of this small town and small community, and I was actually had the privilege of being the doctor's son. My dad owned a family practice there in Coweta. I think I have a picture of that as well, back from the 90s. And my dad was a doctor in the small town. There he is with one of his nurses there. And an actual, you know, kind of interesting story. My dad's dad, so my grandfather, owned the family practice in Coweta before my dad. And it was in this, you know, kind of small one-room practice, and my dad bought it from my grandfather whenever he retired, and then he actually moved the office up the street, bought some land, and built a building there. And it's actually interesting that while growing up in a doctor's house, I learned something really important. I learned the goal of a doctor's office. The goal of a doctor's office is to make sick people well. I know it sounds simple. I know that, you know, that kind of sounds duh, but it was, I found this to be very important while following my dad around. That the goal of a doctor's office was to make sick people well. And so, as I said before, my dad moved the office up the street. Why? Because there were more sick people than they could serve in that small one-room practice. My dad, you know, built a new, bigger building than they had had before. Why? Because there were more sick people than he could serve even in that one space. And then they ended up adding on to the practice. Why? Because there were more sick people than they could care for. My dad welcomed in new clients he didn't know before. Why? Because they were sick. And the goal of a doctor's office is to make sick people well. He brought on more nurses and even more doctors into his practice. Why? Because the goal of a doctor's office is to make sick people well, and there was more sick people than he could care for. And I watched this happen day in and day out as my dad carried out the goal to make sick people well. But every once in a while, something would happen. Every once in a while, someone would come to my dad's practice. Someone would occupy a slot of time. Somebody would come in that wasn't sick. And sometimes these were, you know, maybe some older people or you know, kind of maybe just lonely people. And they would come in and my dad would quickly realize that they weren't sick, that they simply just kind of wanted to socialize. And that's when also I learned something very important. That most times, I think this is really important, and if you're somebody who likes to write things down, I would encourage you to write this down. Most times, we would rather a social club than a doctor's office. Most times, we would rather a social club than a doctor's office. Here's what I mean by that. You ever had a friend who has maybe gone through some trauma? Maybe they went through a particularly hard event, And you knew that you were maybe scheduled to be with them or maybe just on a phone conversation with them. And there's this tendency to avoid talking about that trauma, right? There's a tendency to avoid talking about kind of the elephant in the room or the big hairy thing that happened. There's a tendency to avoid that. Why? Because we would rather a social club than a doctor's office. We would rather this kind of menial social interaction than the tough work of making someone well. Or maybe it's with our finances. You know, we would rather kind of blindly pay our mortgage, right? We would rather that just kind of automatically be taken from our account. We would rather that automatically happen than sit down and actually look at our finances and find out that we can't really afford that mortgage that we're paying. Why? Because many times we would rather this kind of small, menial social interaction than the tough work of making someone well. Or maybe it's with your work, right? Maybe you knew that you had messed up. You know, you had done something wrong. Maybe it was kind of costly to your organization, and you were scheduled to be in front of your boss, in front of your supervisor. And you sat down in that person's office. Of course, when we were going to offices, you sat down in that office, and you had that kind of small bit of small talk before the real conversation happened. And there's a tendency, there's a desire to make that small bit of conversation last the entire time so that we don't have to talk about the thing that I did wrong, so that I don't have to correct anything that I do. Why? Because most times we'd rather a social club than a doctor's office. Most times we would rather this kind of social interaction, this kind of pleasantries, than the tough work of making sick people well. And this is something Jesus knew all too well. This morning, I'm going to be reading from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 9, verses 9 through 13. And we're going to just kind of go verse by verse. But if you have a Bible around with you, or maybe you have a Bible app on your phone, or however you read it, I would encourage you to kind of follow along. And this morning, I'm going to start again in Matthew 9, verse 9. It says this: as Jesus was walking along, he saw a man called Matthew sitting at the tax booth, and he said to him, "Follow me." And he got up, and he followed him. This is kind of a quick happening, but I think it's very important. The gospel writer Matthew describes his own call, right? The gospel writer Matthew describes how he himself was called by Jesus, and we learn that Jesus was walking along, and Matthew, then Levi, was sitting at a tax booth, for he was a tax collector. Now, tax collectors were hated in this time, right? Why? Because they bought contracts from Rome. They bought contracts from Rome to collect a certain amount from their citizens. But what these tax collectors did is they not only collected that amount, but they collected a little bit more and a little bit more and a little bit more to pad their own pockets, right? And there was no rules, there was no law about how much extra they could gather. As long as they gave that contracted amount to Rome, everything was fine. And so it was one of those interactions where you went to someone and you knew you were being cheated, but there was nothing you could do about it, right? You knew you were being cheated, but there was nothing you could do about it. When I think about this, I think about when I go and get my car fixed, right? If my car is making a strange noise and I go to the auto shop and I describe to them the noise, I know in the back of my mind that noise can cost anywhere from $50 to $500. right? Like, I don't know anything about cars. I don't know what's going on in there. This person does. And sometimes they're honest, and that's a great thing. And sometimes they come to me bringing me this part, you know, and I don't know if that part actually came from my car or from someone else's, but they say, this is broken, you need a new one, it's gonna be $500. And I can't do anything in that situation except for to pay the $500 so they can get my car and drive away, right? This was day in and day out for the people of Israel with Levi, the tax collector. But here Jesus is, he calls him. Jesus calls the tax collector and he says, follow me. And Levi leaves everything to go and follow him. And then something happens, right? Because Matthew is called, we read this in verse 10. So Matthew 9, verse 10, we're going to go down the way. It says, and Jesus, as he sat at dinner in the house, many tax collectors and sinners came and were sitting with him and his disciples. So here's what happened. Matthew got called by Jesus. He says, come and follow me. And then Matthew threw this party. Right? Matthew threw this party because he was called by Jesus. He is called by a rabbi, and so he throws a party, and who does he invite? Not the people he was supposed to invite, right? Not the religious leaders, not the higher-ups. He invites his friends, because who else would you invite to a party? He invites his friends, other tax collectors and sinners. And here's the thing we might know about this party. They are loud. It's a loud party. Why do we know this? Because there are other people who come along and hear it happening. This is not like a tea and crumpets kind of party. This is a rambunctious, loud, closed down the block kind of party. And here's something else we understand, that the disciples are uncomfortable. Why? Because we read this in verse 11. When the Pharisees saw this, they said to his disciples, why does your teacher eat with tax collectors and sinners? So here's what's happened. The party is so loud that the Pharisees come by. And when they walk by, kind of on the periphery, kind of on the margins of the party, they see the disciples standing there, right? The disciples are not engaged in the party. They are on the border of the party trying. You ever been at a restaurant and been at the loud table? You know, like there's anything you want to do to be able to just get away from that party. And this is what the disciples do. They're backed so far away from the party that when the Pharisees come by on the margins, they see the disciples there and they ask the disciples, why does your rabbi eat with tax collectors and sinners? I think this is the most important question in the Gospels. Why does your teacher eat with tax collectors and sinners? Jesus hears this question asked. Jesus hears this, and in verse 12, he responds. Verse 12 and 13. But when Jesus heard this, he said, those who are well have no need of a physician, but those who are sick. Go and learn what this means. I desire mercy, not sacrifice. For I have come to call not the righteous, but sinners. Jesus said, my goal is to make sick people well. Why do I eat with tax collectors and sinners? Because they're the ones who need a doctor. This is when we learn something very important about church. And I believe this to be true. Church is not a museum for saints, but a hospital for sinners. So many times we've gotten this backwards. So many times we've built churches for church people. So many times we've built churches for the people that we want to bring to the party, right? We've built churches for people like us, people who act right, people who look respectable, people who do and say the right things, people who already know all the hymns by heart, people who know when to stand up and sit down, people who smell right, people who look right. But what we see is that Jesus, in his ministry, his entire goal was to spend time with the people who needed a doctor because they were the ones who needed healing. So much so to the point that the religious leaders asked, why does he eat with tax collectors and sinners? I wonder when the last time that question was asked of us. Why do they eat with tax collectors and sinners? Why do they eat with those people? Why do they go to that party? Why do they fraternize with those people? My hope, my prayer is that we would do that very thing. Because we know that those are the people who need a doctor the most. Friends, I know this church is going through and that we are going through a great transition in this time. I know that this merger adoption maybe is not the way that you saw this church working out, maybe when you were raised here. Maybe when you were baptized here, maybe when your family was married here, or as you experience these great pivotal moments in your life in this very spot, I know that you did not see this thing happening. But I want to take a moment and celebrate the incredible step of faith that we have made as a church. Not so that we can save ourselves. Not so that we can renovate a building. Not so that we can have an activity that we used to have here. Not so that we can pay more staff to be in an office. Not so that we can do any of those things. My hope, my prayer is that everything we do from here on out would be for one singular purpose: to make sick people well. And that's going to take us down some different paths. That's going to take us to some places that are maybe unsavory. That's going to actually mean bringing people into this church who need Christ the most. And those people don't act right. They may not even look right. But they're the ones for whom the church exists. As I shared with you before, I wanted to share with you some of my favorite books, books that have been the most informative to me in my ministry. And I want to share a book with you now, a book called Deep and Wide by Andy Stanley. And in the book, he says this, that we are called to create a church that unchurched people love to attend. That's even the subtitle of the book. Create a church that unchurched people love to attend. That's my goal in ministry. That's my entire goal, is to create a place that people who need a doctor want to come to. To create not a museum for saints, but a hospital for sinners. My entire goal is to create a church that unchurched people love to attend. And so my hope, my prayer is that we do our ministry outside the walls of this church. We do this work and other people say, why do you eat with those people? Why do you bring those people into the church? And we would say, because they need a doctor. I've had the privilege and the honor to be a part of several churches in my ministry. I'm in my now 10th year of pastoral ministry. Before that, I was in youth ministry, and I've had the honor and privilege of being a part of many different churches, healthy churches, growing churches, churches that were on the brink of growth. And I want to share about a particular moment. I won't tell you the church or the person who shared this, but I want to tell you about a moment that I was sitting in on a meeting of the church. And in that meeting, as we were discussing the growth that this church would experience, somebody said something that I'll never be able to forget. They said, "We've talked a lot about how this church needs to grow, but I don't want to grow too much." I knew what they meant. They were afraid of change. As many of us are, we're afraid of something different. But that stuck in my mind. Because, you know, we would never hear a hospital saying, "We don't want to save too many lives." We would never hear a doctor saying, "I don't want to help heal too many people." Friends, I want to tell you how big this church will be. It will be big enough. I did some research about this particular location, and within a 2.5 mile radius of this church, there are 51,325 people who do not have a religious community, Christian or otherwise. 51,000 people. Friends, this church will be big enough so that those who don't know about Christ can find out about Christ, that we are not the only body of Christ here, that through the church universal, we are going to help strengthen the ministries of God's kingdom here in Walnut Hill and beyond so that all sick people might be well. And so I want to encourage you to do something this week. I want to encourage you to practice something that I've now done for the last year. I've been praying this prayer. Jesus says these words that we've read in Matthew 9. And at the end of the chapter, Matthew 9, 37, Jesus asks his disciples to pray for harvest hands. And so I'm going to encourage you this week to pray this prayer. This says this: "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few." If you like to write things down, I encourage you to write this down. The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Lord of the harvest, send out laborers into your harvest. I encourage you to pray that every day this week. Pray for those who need Christ in their life. Pray for those who are suffering in their marriage. Pray for those who are suffering with their finances, who are struggling raising their children, especially now in quarantine. Pray for those who need a church. Pray for those who need a doctor. And my hope, my prayer is that our hearts would break for them, that we would have compassion for them, and that we would create a church that those unchurched people would love to attend. I'm looking forward to creating that church with you. Amen.
Friends, may we go to God in prayer and receive this pastoral prayer as inspired by our scripture today and through a translation called The Message. Let us pray. O God of Matthew and of people with disreputable character, O God of crooks and riffraff, O God of outsiders, O God of mercy, receive us, the followers of your Son, who strive mightily to figure out your loving all means all love. We confess to you our eagerness to draw lines of hostility in social media. We confess to you our burnout of being restricted and confined by a virus we cannot see nor readily diagnose. We confess to you our own ugliness of thought and deed against people we hold as different from our own opinion, language, culture, and background. O Lord, can you forgive us? Can you remove from our eyes the log beam of self-righteous pride? Can you give us a new heart? Oh, Heavenly Father, by your grace, humble our spirit that we may see your spirit moving to recreate your beloved community. We give thanks for those who hold back the twin viruses of COVID-19 and white supremacy through frontline acts of care and compassionate dialogue laced with humility. We give thanks to those who give their bodies for our sake behind personal protective equipment, and those carrying cardboard signs to awaken angels of a better nature for our black and brown neighbors. We give thanks for awakening a depth of service to feed our neighbor and to use for good technology that gathers us in prayer from our home to shared electronic screens. So, yes, Lord, through the redeeming blood of Christ transfusing love, we, your hospital patients of sin, disease, say yes to your forgiveness. Say yes to your log beam in our eye removal service. And yes to your transplanting our heart of stone with the heart of Jesus' flesh. We lift up to you our Walnut Hill Church and community. We lift up to you the family of Peggy Borges, who entered into your church triumphant and the eternal arms of your Son. We lift to you our tornado-scarred neighborhood, recovering still under blue tarps, plywood windows, and diamond-patterned wire fences. We lift to you our Dallas community, remembering the loss of 5 police officers who gave their lives for our civic freedom to walk on streets of protest on July 7, 2016. Lord, in our imperfect, forgetful ways, you love us still. And may we so love to perfect and to remember one another. For this we pray in the name of Christ, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Get a fire going.
Friends, we thank you for your presence today on our online worship, and we encourage us to continue to remember our vows of membership and vows by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and through our witness. I encourage you to give online, as you may see on screen, to whumc.com/donate. And we invite you to give to that. And also, if you cannot give online, we ask that you send a check via mail to the Walnut Hill address made out to Walnut Hill Church there on your screen. May we pray. Bless, O God, the giving of these gifts to the glory of your name. In Christ's name we pray. And let the people say, Amen.
Again, it has been a blessing to get to worship with you. I want to thank Pastor Tom for his leadership and worship this morning. And again, I want to thank our guest musicians and ask your prayers for Christine as she travels back. As you receive this benediction, I send you forth from this place. Wherever you are gathered, whatever way you are gathered, and that we would join together in a prayer. The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. That we would ask the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest. Go in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
God is good all the time, and all the time, God is good. Thank you for being with us in worship this morning. And I want to especially thank you for your generosity. I hope you will join us in our many Zoom experiences through this week and other ways that we're grouping. And especially, we want to see you next Sunday right here.